and welcome to another episode of the Bechdel Theatre podcast, where we talk about gender and representation on stage. My name's Beth, and I'm your host. So, some of you who are regular listeners may have noticed the absence of Pippa from this episode. Pippa is off in Catalonia, facilitating Theatre of the Oppressed workshops. So, I hope you're having a great time, Pippa, getting a little bit of sun and creating theatre for social and political change. What could be better? I have mostly been watching short runs of plays at Vault Festival, which is over now, so I can't recommend you any more from that festival. What I will say is one of my favourites, I Have a Mouth and I Will Scream by Abby Zakarian, which was directed by Rafaela Marcus. It won the People's Choice Award, which I was really pleased to see that show recognised, because it was just basically a massive feminist battle cry and I loved it. So I really hope that that and some of the other shows that we saw at Vault will be returning. For this episode, we're talking about a show that I saw at Vault that has actually already returned to the stage. It's transferred to the West End. It's Naomi Sheldon's Good Girl. And I did hashtag bring a feminist friend with Lisa Francesca Nand, who is a travel journalist and also fellow podcaster. So it's really good to get some podcasting tips from Lisa. And she talks a little bit about her career. And then we talk about Good Girl. And then we also talk a little bit about Wicked, which Lisa had also been to see recently. So it's a lovely chat that we had in her gorgeous house in leafy Greenwich about a week ago, just before Vault Festival finished. So I really hope you enjoy and stick around to the end, because she's got a great feminist fave, and I will have some recommendations for you for April of shows that are both in London and on tour. So please stick around to the end. And here's Lisa. I'm here with Lisa Francesca Nand. Would you like to introduce yourself, Lisa?
Yes, I'm Lisa, as you said, and I'm a journalist and travel writer, really. I've got my own podcast called The Big Travel Podcast, and I'm on TV and radio a lot as a travel writer.
Ooh.
Travel journalist, I'd say, because cool. I don't really do that much writing anymore. It all seems to be TV and radio.
So where can we see you?
I'm on sometimes on a programme called Rip Off Britain on BBC One with Gloria Hannaford and Angela Rippon. I'm mainly on the radio, though. I do a lot of radio slots. So I'm on all of the radio stations, some more regularly than others, but I've been frequently on BBC Radio 2, Radio 4, Talk Radio. I'm probably doing more than anything else now. I used to work there full time. I was the first ever female presenter on TalkSPORT. And also, because I'm doing all this travel journalism, I've started off the Big Travel Podcast, which you can find at thebigtravelpodcast.com and all podcast outlets such as iTunes and that sort of thing.
Yeah, get that plug in early.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. So this is really intimidating. You're a radio pro.
I started in radio in 2003 when I retrained. I was a corporate events and film producer, and that was really great fun because I got to travel the world paid putting on events and corporate films, but it wasn't what I wanted to do. I wanted to do something more creative. And actually, as a young child and at school certainly, I always wanted to be an actress. So I'm a failed actress, and I remember getting to the point of being, I was about 29, and I thought, this is not what I want to do, this corporate nonsense. I want to be doing something more creative. And I had the choice to go back and retrain and do a postgrad, and it was a choice between drama or broadcast journalism. And I chose broadcast journalism because I thought it might be more stable of an income. But deep down, whenever I see a show in the theatre, I'm always thinking, should I have made that choice to do drama, because I loved it so much. But as it is, the broadcast journalism has gone very well. So it might have been the right choice.
I think so. Well, you've got a lovely house in Greenwich, so
it's not bad.
It seems like it's paid off very
well, you know, but then acting can pay off as well. It's all creative, and I feel like I'm performing in a way because I'm still doing creative things and going on that creative journey and doing things in the public eye for whatever reason we want to do things in the public eye. That's a whole other podcast. What makes people want to perform? So I feel like I'm still performing in a way, but in a way I'm a little bit of a failed actress and a failed pop star. Because I never even tried to do it.
We've all failed at the things that we had on that list when we were seven.
I think ambitions change as you get older, and I think if only you knew when you were 16 that those decisions that you make at that point are really going to be life-changing and might set you off along the wrong path.
Yeah, yeah, or the right path.
Or the right path, so, yes.
Just a path. And then the things that you can't even choose, that's not based on your decision.
There's so many things that are out of your reach and out of your control at a young age. But a lot of people get into performing when they're at school and they do really well. But then they leave school and they get distracted by, I don't know, boys and drink and nightclubs and things, which I got distracted by in Brighton. And I forgot that I wanted to be a performer until later on when I got stuck in a job that was quite good for money and quite a good profile. And it was paying the bills. You know, we all often have to take these jobs to pay the bills, and then sometimes you get stuck. So it wasn't until I was 29 when I realised, no, actually, I'm going to change this. And, you know, as you said, it's turned out quite well. It was never too late. And even at 29, I managed to, you know, change my path and end up on the right one, even though it's not acting, which is why I'm a big fan of mentoring schemes. I was on a mentoring scheme myself. It's actually for people with more experience than those youngsters we're talking about. But I was on the Women in Film and TV mentoring scheme in 2014. And that's a brilliant organisation in itself, but a brilliant mentoring scheme where they put people in touch, people that have had at least 5 or more years of experience in film and TV in the industry, and then they put them in touch with a mentor who will guide them and introduce them to people and let them network with people. And networking is actually often seen as a dirty word, but actually I think these days we're turning that around, as networking is really important, particularly for women, because we might not have that network or the confidence or the ability or the guts you need to go and approach someone and say, hey, you know, would you mind sort of helping me out or introducing me to that person? I think mentoring is particularly key to women and particularly in the creative industry.
So who was your mentor? Did you have somebody?
My mentor was actually a lady who I think is now the CEO of a TV production company called Shine, Lisa Perrin, and she was wonderful. But what she did was, I only met with her twice, what she did was recognise straight away what I needed, and that was to put me in touch with someone else that she knew, a lady called Ruth Pitt, who's just a dynamic, wonderful lady who has made documentaries and been at the head of departments in the BBC and is very, very good and well known in her field. And she was able to help me as the executive producer get the documentary that I was filming at the time made and sold to the Discovery Network.
Oh, wow.
And broadcast all over the world on various Discovery channels. It's having the networks there, having the people, that the path that you can see, and mentoring schemes, particularly for women, I think can be very, very helpful with that. And it got I made a documentary called First Heartbeat on, and it was broadcast on Discovery and TLC in the UK. It was about my experience with miscarriage. We were in every single newspaper in the country, from the Daily Mail to the Observer, in all the women's magazines. I went on Loose Women, I went on Woman's Hour, I went on BBC News, I went on Sky News, and it was brilliant. We really opened the dialogue about miscarriage, which is a very important subject to many people. It affects far more people than one would realise until you go through it. And so that was a really brilliant thing to do.
That's amazing. What a great project.
Thank you.
Is it still out there? Can people?
It is, yeah. Well, actually, I think it stopped going around the world on the Discovery Networks, and I know this because whenever it was broadcast somewhere, I'd get a flurry of emails from Argentina or Brazil or Croatia or totally random places all over the world. I've stopped getting those emails now, and I would like to speak to the company to put it online so we can try and get it somewhere so people can access it. I think it is available illegally online. So
But, you know, we'll wait for it to become legal.
Oh, yeah.
So, wow. What an impressive person. We're so lucky to have you on our podcast after, you know, Women's Hour and Loose Women.
I wouldn't say that. I'm still doing my own podcast. You know, I'm doing that all on my own. And
the big travel podcast.
The big travel podcast, yes. And
do you get to travel with that?
So when I trained as a journalist, I got my first job. Because I was 29, you know, and I'd already had experience in the workplace, I managed to rise quite quickly through radio. So I got a job at the BBC on a station in the south in Brighton called BBC Southern Counties, as it was then called, doing their travel news and then doing news reading and reporting, a lot of reporting for them, and then got my own show on weekends, a music show. Music's always been a big passion of mine. I really enjoyed that. And whilst I was there, I was also doing travel news for lots of other radio stations at this organisation that sort of satellites all the travel news out. And I started work on a radio station called TalkSPORT, which is a national station. And then I emailed the manager there because I became quite a part of the show. These lovely men on the mid-afternoon show called Hawksby and Jacobs. And they let me become a big part of their show. And we used to have quite a laugh whenever I came on. It was a really nice vibe. So I emailed, I thought, right, I'm going to take advantage of this. I'm going to email the controller, the editor of the station, to see if there's anything that I could do for them directly. And he said, yeah, come in. And within a month, I was a co-presenter on one of their shows. And so I
sent that email. Wow.
Send the email. You know, I think that email these days, you know, gives you the more confidence. You know, I probably wouldn't have called him up, put it that way. But email was fine.
Think about what you're going to say.
He replied. And so I was the very first female presenter on TalkSport, even though I know nothing about sport.
Woo!
It was a popular culture, late night show, current affairs, that sort of thing. So that was brilliant practice because we had 5 hours of live talk radio a night to fill. And I was Ian Collins's sidekick. I'm still in touch with Ian. He's now on LBC. And from there, after about 2 years, I got a travel article published. I'd been on holiday to Cuba and I'd already travelled quite significantly with my previous work, and also for fun. It's always been a passion of mine, and I grew up in Spain as well, which helps. And I eventually left TalkSport and became a full-time travel journalist. And I had, for a few years, I had this amazing contract where I had to do 2 luxury travel pieces a month. I persuaded them to have travel films because I've always wanted to make films. So I had to do 2 luxury travel films a month from anywhere in the world. And how travel press...
I had to go to luxury travel places.
It was awful.
I love it.
So how the travel press works is a lot of the time that journalists are invited on press trips, which are probably paid for by a posh hotel. So luckily I had a confirmed commission for everything I did. So I could really go on any press trip. I could just pick or choose.
That's
and I
amazing.
Went all over the world, really. But I'd already done a lot of travelling, so it was just sort of adding to that. And now I've got a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old. I don't travel the world as much as I used to, but a lot of the advice I give on TV and radio is about consumer travel. So I know about if you've had a problem with a booking, or travel in the news as well. You know, what's Ryanair up to this week if they're doing something disastrous?
Hence
which they usually are.
Britain thing.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah, so I do consumer travel and I still travel. I go away every 6 weeks usually now, but often to Spain, where I grew up, and that's sort of home to me. So
yeah.
It travel changes when you've got kids.
Yeah, I imagine. Well, I don't get to travel as it is. I can't even imagine if you factor in someone else into the mix. I've been to Belfast and Edinburgh in the last 5 years.
Well, Belfast is a really
Belfast
cool place to visit
great.
These days.
Yeah,
interestingly,
yeah.
I was interviewing on my podcast this month. I've got Eamon Holmes, and we had a really good chat about Belfast and when he was growing up there.
Yeah. So how does he feel about, did he talk about like tourism, like people taking the bus around all the kind of highly political, difficult areas of Belfast?
No, we didn't. And actually, now you mention it, that would have been a really good question to ask.
Man.
We spoke more about his childhood there and how it was growing up under the, you know, he was in the middle of a war zone, essentially, by the time he got to his teenage years, and how that affected him, which was fascinating. But it's a very, very cool place these days. A really cool place.
Yeah, I'm going to listen to your podcast now.
Yeah,
it sounds like a really interesting angle on it. So it's not just like, hey, check out my amazing holiday I had. It's like...
No, it's really not. This month as well, we've had Hannah Martin, who's a pro makeup artist with Bobby Brown. And she's had this outwardly charmed life. I mean, she's beautiful. She's got thousands and thousands of followers on Instagram and YouTube. When she posts herself putting on her morning makeup, within an hour, she's got 2,000 likes or something. It's incredible. She's very popular and deservedly so, because she's wonderful. But we also spoke about her experience with miscarriage and IVF and baby loss and her struggle to become a mum, and how she was injecting IVF drugs hidden in her sock in New York Fashion Week when she's having this wonderful, outwardly glamorous time. So the strap line for the big travel podcast is exploring life stories through travel. And it's so much more than travel. The travel is, it's almost like a euphemism for the travel, a big journey of life, as well as, you know, where you went on your holidays. It encompasses all that.
That's great. I want to listen to it now.
And I'm using my journalistic contacts to try and get as a wide, diverse range of people as possible. So everything from politicians to Paralympic skiers. I've got Millie Knight coming on in a few weeks' time. She's at the Paralympics at the moment. And she's a blind skier. Yes, exactly. That's exactly it. I want to get as diverse as characters as possible on there and talk about their life journey and their travel while we're at it.
That's kind of like Desert Island Discs.
That's exactly what it is. I'm totally ripping off Desert Island Discs, but not for music, but for travel. But that's how I explain it to a lot of people.
That makes so much sense. I love it.
It's a lovely idea. In fact, because music's always been such a big part of my life as well, I do ask them a musical question at the end. And it's not always about their favourite bands and acts. So people get a bit embarrassed. Like Molly Hughes, for example, who's only 26, 27 now, but she's climbed Everest twice. She's the youngest woman in the world to have climbed it from both the north and south sides. So she's a great interview. But the song, the memorable moment from her travel experiences was actually listening to Britney Spears at the top of Everest in what they call the death zone. They're listening to it in a tent after a really hard day climbing.
What Britney Spears song did she listen to?
I think it was Hit Me Baby One More Time. But it wasn't, obviously, this is not her favourite band. So she was embarrassed saying it, but it gets a really nice story out.
Never be embarrassed of Britney.
No, that's true. That's true.
So the reason you are here with me is, or I'm here with you in your home, is we went to see a show called Good Girl, which we went to see at Vault Festival. It's now finished at Vault Festival, but it's moving on to Trafalgar Studios, West End. So I first saw this show in Edinburgh, and I saw it on a day where I had seen 5 shows the day before, and I saw 5 other shows on the day it was. But I just remember it standing out as being a little glimmer of joy in my rainy fringe. So I really wanted to bring a feminist friend to go and see it, because it seems like something that I feel like a lot of people can possibly relate to or find something in it that makes you smile. What were your thoughts when you got invited to come and see this show with us and journey to Default Festival? We'll talk about the journey, because that's what your podcast is about. And what was your preamble to seeing the show?
Well, I was very excited to hear about your podcast because I think it's a wonderful thing. And I'm aware of the Bechdel test in terms of film, because that was something that was important to us, especially when I've been doing things with women in film and TV. But I hadn't heard of doing it with theatre. And I think it's such a brilliant idea and a very, very good podcast. So I was really pleased to get invited along and to have something to do with that. My journey, my literal journey, was amazing, because the Vault Festival is such an incredible place. And I came out of Waterloo and I first took a wrong turn and ended up in some back street where they also had another show going around the back of some car park amongst the bins, and that's quite an exciting way to enter a festival. And then it was just beautiful and covered in twinkly lights and the graffiti, and then you walk underneath the arches and it's almost like a speakeasy. It's this hidden venue, and you open the doors and there's all this little warren of bars, and at the box office you can see that there's loads of shows on, and it just felt like a really good, fabulous festival, great creative environment with drinks available, which is one, a lot of things that I love. So I convinced my husband, actually, we're going back next week to whether we'll get tickets to a show or just go to the bars. I don't know. I'm going to see if there's anything available. You know, again, now we've got kids, when we do get our one night a week which we're very lucky to have because we've got people on hand to babysit, often we just go out and sit and talk and drink or go to the pub and have something to eat. So things like the cinema and theatre, even though we love that sort of thing, but we just never have time for it anymore. Because, you know, when you've got that one precious night out, you just can't go to, you know, you don't want to go and sit and watch something and not have that chance to talk, you know, much as you love the cinema or theatre. Anyway, so we loved it so much that we're going to go back there. And the show itself, I mean, we can talk about it now more in depth, but I really, really, really enjoyed it.
Oh, good. I'm so glad you enjoyed it. Because it was, it was my choice, and it was one that I really enjoyed at Edinburgh, and it was one that I kind of felt a bit sad that I'd watched it on my own, because it felt like something that definitely is kind of a shared experience. I mean, I didn't watch it on my own because I watched it with a room full of people, and I felt like I had sort of bonded with the other people in the room. What's your favourite thing about it?
My favourite thing about the show was the fact that I could identify with it a lot. And I think a lot of us could identify with it a lot. And not just because it was in the 90s. I think I'm a similar age of Naomi Sheldon.
Yeah.
I think I'm a similar age and had similar experience. But I felt it was very, very real. And it reminded me of those performances where people read from their diaries.
Oh, yeah.
And I have diaries like that. I can really relate to her experience. I have those diaries with terrible hormonal adolescent musings, and I feel that there were sort of signs of that in there, and also a lot of other coming of age books and films. did you ever remember, you might be too young for it, actually I think I was too young for it, I think there's something that stood the test of time, but books like that I read as a very young teenager called Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret.
Yes!
And those sort of books, it really reminded me of that, you know, really the experience of being a young girl, you know, periods and first sexual awakenings and boys. And I thought it was very, I mean, obviously it passes the Bechdel test because it's a one-woman show, but I thought there was a lot to be said there about feminism that was unspoken but hinted at, such as when she was, I think she was caught kissing a boy or something at school and she got really told off and he didn't. And I can relate to that. I'm sure in my school, in many schools, certainly the unjustness of the situation was quite a real thing, that she got told, women get told they're a slag and boys are just being boys. Yeah. And also when she was harassed on the bus by men, it was all quite familiar. I couldn't relate to the, she obviously hinted at a deep level of anxiety, and I think we all suffer from anxiety, and I know I have suffered from a certain amount of anxiety, but she was clearly suffering from something a lot deeper than just sort of surface level general anxiety. It was hinted at, she never got diagnosed, or she never really spoke about it, and I thought that was interesting. But overall I thought it was just a really, really wonderful performance.
Yeah, I loved how early that feminism thing was brought in as well, with the, they said that it was almost one of the first things she said was this experience of standing inside of the swimming pool and remembering that they'd said this when she was kissing the boy. And I think at that point she was very young, maybe not even in secondary school, or maybe first year of secondary school. So the story starts when she's kind of pre-pubescent, like very early feelings of puberty. She talks about the tingles, the swayzies.
I love that.
So good.
And also her use of music was very, I really enjoyed the use of music, and I loved the songs she chose. It was interesting to note that the music wasn't actually always chronological. She was playing things like ABBA when she was 14, and that wasn't, you know, ABBA had been out, those songs had been out a long time before she was 14.
Although ABBA did have a revival in 1999.
Actually, that's funny that you should say that. And she did actually mention the ABBA Gold album, which I had, and I'd love to listen. It made me want to go home and put that on.
Yeah.
I've got it on CD somewhere, I think.
I remember, like, there was this trend of all these pop stars of the 90s doing ABBA covers.
Oh, yes, there was.
I really remember, because I was like the right age, and I think Steps did like an ABBA song, and Bewitched did an ABBA song, and Billie Piper did an ABBA song.
What,
like,
did Billie Piper do?
I don't know. Well, I don't think she released it, but like they performed them on Top of the Pops or something as like a big ABBA celebration.
Oh, ABBA are just the best.
And it was when Mamma Mia came out as well.
Of course,
which I always reference as, like, you know, you say the women in theatre can't sell, the biggest selling musical, Mamma Mia, passes the Bechdel test with flying colours.
Absolutely. And Wicked, which I saw the other day, which I absolutely loved. Yeah. I hadn't seen it before. That was just wonderful. I know we're digressing, but I really enjoyed
it. We can digress and talk about Wicked, because I haven't actually seen it.
Oh, it's just the best. It is. It's just heartwarming, and two strong female lead characters. The men are there, but it's about this female relationship. And also knowing the original story of The Wizard of Oz, it's fascinating to see how they've come up with an alternative reality, an alternative way of seeing things and what was really going on behind the scenes. And I liked the story of Wicked even more than I liked The Wizard of Oz, which I was a huge fan of
film.
And I liked the story better. It's more heartwarming. And
I wonder if it could win me over, because I'm such a big fan of The Wizard of Oz. I would fear that it would be like this stepping on my childhood. That's not canon.
I think you'd like it, because it doesn't mess with the original story. That's still there, but it sort of gives you the reasons why certain people became certain people. And also, everything is not as it seems. Like, good is not necessarily good, and evil is not necessarily evil, which is a delicious notion, I think.
Well, that's a lot in that. It's very rich. I've heard the songs. The songs are great.
Yes, the songs are really good.
Yeah, so that's obviously provided a lot of joy for people, and people have been telling me to see it for years, so I've really got to get on it.
Yeah, me too. I mean, I think I'm 10 years too late. I haven't seen it either until, you know, last week.
Wow, well,
so
thank God it's still running.
Yes,
look at this.
Definitely. Yeah.
Women selling out the West End. Good girl.
Yes, back let's to good return. Girl. Yes.
Let's return from our little tangent. The music, as you said, wasn't chronological, and it felt like, oh, it's very of its time. But then she's playing Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson is eternal. Right? There was a couple of Michael Jackson songs in there.
Yeah, I think there was definitely more than one.
Yeah, and I really felt like it, I mean, maybe it is because I could relate to a lot of her specific experiences, but it felt like it could almost be timeless. Like, I could imagine this being a piece that would still be relevant in 20, 30 years time. But yes. Then I thought, actually, people younger than us, they'll have grown up with the internet, and it might have changed the way they look at sex and sexuality and gender and things like that.
Yes, maybe in that case it really was of its time, or is of its time, you know, referring back to what she was talking about in the 90s. It was certainly, as far as I know, a more innocent time, that they were using mirrors to check out their vaginas because they had no idea what it would look like. And now, obviously, it's not something I've Googled, but I could imagine.
I wonder if people still do that, though, because there's something about it being yours. There is a big thing on, like, so it's about not just, it's a one woman show, right? But it's about not just one woman. It's about this whole friendship group, and that they go through teenage years together. And I just love that. I had such a clear image in my mind of, like, these girls gathering around at their sleepover and all getting out their compact mirrors and looking at their vaginas together.
I think it's certainly not something I did, but I did a lot of the things they were talking about, and all those sleepovers and the discussions they were having about Patrick Swayze. And at one point, were they practicing kissing on their arm or something? I'm sure I remember. And you know, I remember doing similar things. It's very real and very relatable there. And actually, having known nothing about Naomi Sheldon, I was wondering whether this was a biographical or autobiographical performance, or if it wasn't. And I've done a little bit of Googling since, and I still don't know, actually.
I think it's intentionally mysterious, because I really like, I really like the idea that it kind of leaves you wondering, but also kind of doesn't. I don't know if it really matters. It kind of, it's truthful enough that you think, oh yeah, some of this is definitely real. And but then that's because I think also some of it is true for me. But I like that she hasn't said, this is me, this is my journey, because the audience, I feel like we felt quite safe that we were in a fictional world, because she brought in quite early that the kid's name in the show is Gigi. And so, you know, this isn't Naomi. This isn't her story. Even though some of it might be Naomi, there's that level of fiction, the level of imagination around it, that you think, okay, we can relax into it. She's telling a story. She's not, like, putting out all of her, like, stuff on the table and asking the audience to be her therapist. But she's giving us hints that maybe some of it might be based in a truth.
I'm guessing that much of it, a lot of it, is based in truth. But you're right, it was a work of fiction as well. And you almost get the sense that actually there is quite a crossover between fiction and non-fiction. When people write books, particularly, I've tried to write books and haven't managed to do it yet. But whenever I have written a few chapters, you know, it's always got things that I have personally been through, you know, because that's what you've got. That's your experience, and that's what you've got to go on for your creative references.
Yeah.
But it's interesting that you should mention therapy, because I guess it is a thought form of therapy, and there might be a lot of people that can relate to that as well, you know, that sort of cathartic expulsion of things that have happened to you.
Yeah, it definitely felt like more like therapy for the audience than for the performer, though. You know, it felt like the performer, the writer and performer were the same person, was very kind of in control of the situation and very, like, accomplished in her portrayal of all of these different characters. And the audience was on a roller coaster, on an absolute roller coaster of feelings. I feel like taking us through that, but in the hands of somebody who's so capable on stage and somebody who has such humour and such warmth about her, I feel like, yeah, cathartic's a really good word for it.
And what you're going back to the actual Bechdel test, although it was a one-woman show, like you said, there were actually four women there in that show, and she was all of them, and they were sitting having conversations with or without mirrors on their nether bits. And so there was that whole conversation between women, although they were often talking about men.
They were quite often talking about men, yeah. But then, like, a lot of the time when they were talking about men, they were talking about men in general, as opposed to obsessing over specific boys, which I found quite cool. Like,
yeah, that's true. Although there was a bit of a Patrick Swayze obsession.
But I like the way his name got appropriated and taken to describe a feeling that they had. And yeah, it might be because the feeling was associated with watching him in Dirty Dancing. But, you know, the use of Swayze as something to describe something that comes from within themselves, and that they got from touching each other's arms in a certain way, I just thought was like, they're not really talking about Patrick Swayze anymore, are they?
It's a great name for it, though. It sounds like some sort of, like, a medical condition or something.
Swayze.
Poor old Patrick, God rest his soul.
I love that disclaimer that she gave.
Yes, exactly.
She's like,
yeah,
he wasn't dead then, so it wasn't it wasn't weird.
I think we can say what we like about him. He was a good guy generally.
Yeah, he seemed seems like a cool guy. It's weird, actually, because the other show that we were looking at, Vault Festival, the Year of the Rooster Monk, is based around the movie Ghost. And Good Girl actually talks about the movie Ghost. It's weird how these things, like, pop up, these references, once you think, I hadn't thought about Ghost for years, and now suddenly I'm thinking about Patrick Swayze again in all these different ways.
I'm guessing, and I'm completely making this up now, but I'm guessing that the age of people that are performing at the Vault Festival, and like we spoke about, people getting their cultural references from a very strong period of influence in everyone's life, those sort of teenage years when you're full of hormones and everything is new and everything is so important, whether that's good important or bad important, you know, the highs and lows and emotions of being a teenager, I think, are never really replicated later in life. I think the age of people that are performing at such a festival like that, you know, that is their key time of influences, so that is inevitably going to crop yeah. up. But for me, being of a similar age, I'm assuming to Naomi Sheldon, maybe a little bit older, but being able to, you know, I was a teenager in the 90s, and you know, it was definitely something I could really relate to.
Yeah, and the same, I think I'm a couple of years younger than her, but I mean, maybe I'm guessing your age, Naomi, if she's listening.
I'm guessing she's about 35. That's what I'm
thinking. Yeah, I feel like I'm 30, so yeah.
We could
so
Google this.
I feel like we might be either side of her age.
Yes, exactly.
But both yeah. found a huge amount of things to relate to in
yes,
it,
which is good. It's and, a wide age range.
Yeah, and the music, again, going back to that music, it's like, it's so visceral when you hear the chords of a song that you heard when you were going through all these really intense emotions. It just gets the audience immediately on your side and in the same zone together.
I'm sure even my mum, we were talking about the longevity of it and whether it was of its time, but I'm sure even my mum could relate to those feelings. She might have been having them in the 50s and 60s, but it is classic, and it is about the human condition in a way, more than the actual period in time. For us that remember and were teenagers in the 90s, you know, there's 10 years between us or whatever, we could still relate to that. But I'm sure anyone who's ever been a teenager, which is everyone, can actually relate to that. You know, yeah. The cultural references might change, but I think the emotions and the things that you're going through.
Absolutely, definitely. And sadly, the sexism.
Yes, absolutely. And I'd like to think that's changed. I don't really know many teenagers at the moment. My kids are very young and my friends are much older. I hope that things are changing now with the yeah. whole new wave of feminism that seems to be cropping up, with the whole Me yeah. Too and the whole sort of we're not going to take it anymore attitude. But then I fear that what other things that you read about kids and porn and online porn and how young men think women should look and perform and how women think that they should look and perform, and this whole weird aesthetic of people that are very dressed up to the nines and worried about plastic surgery. You know, that's what you see a lot in the public eye, whether the teenagers on the ground or in the schools are actually influenced by that, or they can sort of rise above it. I don't know.
Well,
imagine that some can,
there's
some
that
can't.
Thing about being on camera all the time, and like, you know, in the show she kind of talks about her like anxieties, and I feel like, is there any worse way to increase anxiety than feeling like you're constantly under surveillance, which in a way with social media, like now we are constantly having a camera pointed in our faces and knowing that that camera's not only going in the family album or going to be like sent round to our friends, but like, you know, could be with us for the rest of our lives. You know, there's embarrassing photos of me from when I was a teenager that I've got stuck in an album at home that would just be terrifying if they came out, like, you know, if I ever did become like in the public eye or famous in any way. I could just imagine having these pictures of like me and my friends in our underwear at a sleepover posted on, you know, in the sun or whatever. And that's something that kids nowadays, if you're 13, 14 now, I imagine is just a reality, that you know that everything you do is potentially public. So,
and also on that line, the feeling of inadequacy when people are posting these beautifully tampered with selfies, if they are. I mean, I never use filters or anything like that. I try them and I think, no, that just looks weird.
Yeah.
I prefer the natural, you know, sort of wrinkles and all. But the ideals that they're living up to are not realistic. They're not real. Not even realistic. They're not real. All those doctored, you know, the makeup they put on, the bigger, they inflate their eyes, the size of their eyes, their
yeah.
lips, and you know, there's, and everything on, I mean, teenagers probably don't use Facebook, but everything on social media, you know, you're using, you're referencing this glamorous lifestyle, and actually that is their edited highlights. You know, when they're at home, they're they're sitting around in slobbing around like the rest of us. But and when you're in that vulnerable position of being an adolescent or a teenager, you could easily think that everyone's living this amazingly glamorous lifestyle and you're not. And that could lead to all sorts of feelings of inadequacy.
But then also leads to kind of finding other people who are feeling the same way as you. Like, because I think one of the things that the character in Good Girl goes through is feeling like she's the only one. And when she shares with her teenage friends, you know, have you ever felt like you're just too much or you feel too strongly about everything? And she shares this experience of just bursting in tears. Randomly, she'll just burst into tears. She goes through this phase in her life and she talks to one of her friends about it and her friends goes, no. And I just thought, imagine if that character could have been able to go on social media and Google, I just keep bursting into tears, how much information she would find out there. So even though she might be seeing the world through, nowadays, that kind of character might be seeing the world through an Instagram filter, I think we're so lucky that if we have something that's worrying us or on our mind, we can just look it up.
What she was hinting at, I have no experience to diagnose people or whatever. Yeah. Like, my husband's a mental health professional, so maybe I you know, have some proximity to it. But the intensive feelings that she was describing, I suspected something like bipolar disorder. Yeah. Because she was so intensely low at times. Yeah. But then also had these incredible highs where she could feel things, I forget what it was, but shooting through her fingertips. She was almost like Katy Perry in the fireworks video.
Yeah.
You know, that,
yeah.
I think she was describing something like these incredible highs, I love flowing through her, and these wonderful highs, but then these terrible
and the
lows.
Fact that that carried on throughout her into adulthood as well, because the play takes us on to her early 20s and she's still going through these experiences. So I think when it comes up early on, you think, oh yes, I remember hormones, puberty, but then she kind of continues it on. But I really love the fact that this stuff comes in and it's kind of hinted at, but it's not in any way marketed as like, this is a play about serious mental health, blah blah blah. You know, it's not about conditions, it's not about diagnosing, it's not about symptoms, it's about one person's experience. So
yes,
yeah.
And all the things that we could relate to, all the adolescent things, you know, she takes that one step further and it's clear that she does have some sort of difference to the average. And,
yeah.
But you're right, it's not necessarily spelled out. I think the only thing I didn't like about it, and this is actually probably a positive thing, it's a compliment in a way, is that the way that it was brought up to 2018 so quickly, I kind of wanted it to go on. I wanted to know more. So almost, it was an hour long, and almost to me, it actually could have been longer because I was so interested in what she was saying, and I wanted to experience that journey from her 20s until now. There was a whole 10 years that was skipped out, but I guess in the constraints of time,
an Edinburgh show, isn't it? Like,
exactly.
You sort of fit it into an hour. Yeah, I would. I mean, maybe she should make a Good Girl chapter two.
I could have definitely, you know, it left the audience wanting more, certainly from my point of view, which is actually a good thing. It is a compliment. It'd be awful if you're sitting there looking at your watch. So that maybe that was the right way to do it.
Yeah.
But I do feel there was a whole chunk of time that I'd love to have seen what Gigi was doing in that time.
Yeah.
She was in London, you know, she'd been in all sorts of trouble, ended up at some really dodgy situations, and she was still good friends with at least one of the girls, and we could relate to that you're not good friends or in touch, you know, people are, you're going to lose people along the way, but she still had that.
I did wonder
friendship.
What happened to her other friends, because she remained friends with one of the four of the friendship group and lived in a student house with that friend, but they didn't say what happened to the other two.
I think it was hinted at before that, when they fell out, didn't they, when they were about 14 or 15, and it was like, you're too intense, we don't want to talk to you anymore. There was a letter passed, a note passed in class.
Oh.
I mean, again, that would be texted now or splashed all over social media or slagged off, you know, publicly in some way. But then it was a note passed to her in class.
That moment was a real wrench, that you're too intense bit. My stomach was like, she's not.
Especially when you are feeling intense. Yeah. It just makes it worse. It's like, I'm going to feel this intensely.
Stop feeling. Stop feeling stuff.
You can't make yourself stop feeling, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I guess she said she did, didn't she? Numbed it with men and one-night stands and nights out and drink. And
masturbation.
And masturbation.
Oh,
yeah,
my
exactly.
God. There's an extended masturbation description.
I forgot about that.
Yeah. But isn't that great when you've got a show where the masturbation bit isn't the bit that you remember afterwards?
Absolutely. It felt quite natural and normal and part of the dialogue, rather than, oh, this is a show
exactly.
that includes a masturbation scene.
And I didn't feel like there was anything that was in there as like a kind of shock factor for a show that is, describes itself as talking a lot about sexuality and vaginas. There was nothing in there that felt like it was there to make the audience go, oh my God. It was all in there to make at least somebody in the audience think, oh, that's me.
Yes, it was very real. And it'd be interesting to hear what men think of that, because obviously they don't really know. It was exposing the inner workings of the female mind. And that to me is very relatable. It's very interesting to see, if I was able to take my husband, I'd love to see what he thinks of it and see if he sees that that's what women can relate to, and his take on it. It might be a completely different thing.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing about taking my partner. I was like, I wonder if he would understand what this show is about. I'd love to go up to one of the men that were in the audience and be like, did you get that feeling that we had when we were watching that?
And or what you said about going to Edinburgh and not being able to talk about it with people afterwards. Yeah. As a journalist in me, always wanted to go and interview and put a microphone in people's face afterwards, go, what are you doing? And like, actually, you know,
do some vox pops.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Instant reactions.
So in that case, I mean, I think it's such a brilliant show, and I think Naomi Sheldon has done such a great job, because there's so much to say about it, and it was just all packed into that 1 hour and left us all wanting more.
Yeah, absolutely. Who would you take to see it if at Trafalgar Studios? Your husband?
Yes.
I would like to go to see with somebody younger and find out these questions that we're asking.
Yeah,
you know,
quite
if
possibly.
I
would like to go and see it with a man, definitely, to get their take on it.
Yeah.
And maybe one of my gay friends, actually, might be quite good. Like a whole sort of section of my friendship would be interesting. But I would, if I get the opportunity to, I'd actually go and see it again a second time. Or a third time, as it might be for you.
I could kind of almost imagine it turning into like a TV show or something. Because it reminded me a little bit of when I was a teenager, the book Angus, Thongs and Full Frontal Snogging came out.
I don't know that one.
And it was just, it was like told through the medium of a teenage girl's diary. And then that got made into, I think, a film.
But I did hear, or I did read online, that actually she is in discussion with a TV company.
Oh, really? Oh, I wasn't the first person that thought of that then.
No, exactly. No. So it'd be very interesting to see whether they actually dramatise it, whether they bring her and her friends to life.
Yeah.
Because it's very difficult to do a one-woman TV
show,
isn't it?
Yeah.
So I imagine they would actually.
Can you imagine her playing all the four different characters? Yeah, I mean, it's such a difficult thing with shows. I mean, the Bring a Feminist Friend thing is trying to get people in to see a show that you might not otherwise have watched. But it's such a tricky thing when you see a show like Good Girl that seems to be so resonant with so many people and like it would chime with so many experiences, but you can't recommend it to everyone. And there's such a, it's one of the frustrating things about theatre, is the magic of it is being in the same room at the same time, but then you can't get everyone in the country in the same room at the same time to watch a show like Good Girl.
Well, with a show like Good Girl, it's always going to be a relatively small audience. And I wonder if there's one, if one day that will change, like the whole comedians doing big stage performances live at the Apollo, wherever, these are big venues. And I wonder if that will eventually translate to things like one woman or one man shows that are used to being in such smaller venues and in Fringe and that sort of thing, and take them to these big stages. I don't know what the stage he's going to be at now.
It's a studio space, so it'll be, I assume, like it's bigger than Vault, but
and
I assume
it'll
still be
stage
intimate.
In one of the classic theatres.
Well, yeah, it's a new, like Trafalgar Studios is a new build, so it'll be a new studio space. But I think there is a level of intimacy where she makes eye contact with members of the audience that it wouldn't necessarily have if it was, I'm trying to imagine it in like Wembley Stadium or like, you know, or even in a big West End theatre. There is a level, you couldn't really go over 1,000 seats to have a show that, where every single member of the audience feels like they're breathing the same air as the performer.
Yes, quite possibly. And it's always funny, and performers in such venues do this a lot when they will look at you and bring you in, because it's a little bit awkward sometimes, but then it's soon that awkward to me, that awkwardness soon dissipates. But I imagine to more awkward people than me, it might sort of stay there. Yeah. My husband, when many years ago, he's got this wonderful story about going to see this play at Edinburgh. And it was, something had happened. I think the venue had burnt down the night before. And anyway, they managed to it was cancelled, but then at the last minute they decided to, they could put it on maybe elsewhere or something. But it was a very intense show where they involved the audience, and it was just David and another guy sitting behind him. And there was a lot of shouting in his face and pointing at you, how, you know,
sort
of bringing him in. He said it was like the most intense hour of his life.
In a good way?
This is really awkward, this is uncomfortable, maybe it's kind of good. He said the performance was good. But interestingly, back in London a couple of years later, he was telling this story because it's become a bit of a story that's sort of dined out on. And he realised that one of the actors who was then a friend was actually, when he told this story, he was like, that was me, I was in that show.
Oh my God!
And the actor said it was one of the worst times of my life because we were pointing and shouting and, you know, you abused me sort of thing at least one audience member and another guy sitting behind
him. No, I think you have to be so careful with putting something like that in a show that, like, relies on the audience being okay with being...
shouted at.
Being shouted at or being involved in some way. Like, actually... just before we went to see Good Girl together, I had that experience at Vault Festival where I went to see these two shows in shipping containers, and I found it to be a really horrible experience because it was immersive, but in a way where they did warn me that it was going to be in complete darkness and it was going to have scenes of violence and scenes of sexual violence, but I felt like the show so relied on me being there for it to happen that I felt, even though they said I could leave at any time, I felt responsible for it. Like, probably your husband did. If he left, there wouldn't have been a show. Like, it would have been completely... all these people would have wasted their time turning up and learning their lines or whatever. And that was the thing with being in this shipping container in Vault Festival. It was Void, it's called. And it was a wonderful piece of writing that I was listening to. But I was just having so many intense emotions. I didn't feel like I was able to properly appreciate the artistry of what I was hearing and the kind of go on the journey with the character, because I was so worried about my own journey of being trapped inside the performance space and what would happen if I leave, and would I have to speak to the usher on the door about why I was leaving, and it was just kind of easier to stay even though I felt like I was putting myself through something quite emotionally disturbing and unpleasant by staying. I felt like I don't want to let everyone down. It's this communal experience of, like, if I walk out, everyone's going to look at me and they're going to know that I was the one that left, and, like, they're going to, you know, the usher's going to be like, are you okay? Which sometimes, if you're having, like, a really awkward experience, somebody saying, are you okay, can be, like, the worst thing ever. So, yeah.
It'd be awful to burst into tears and run out, wouldn't it? But maybe that was what was intentional. If you think of theatre as, like, art, you know, the art of it is making people uncomfortable. And it's not necessarily always... I'm making it up now, but it's not necessarily always about enjoying the experience, but it being an experience that affects you.
Yeah, definitely.
And is a memorable experience, because it certainly sounds like it was a very memorable experience. I'm not sure if you'd repeat it.
It was. I mean, it's hard, because on the one hand, I think it's very important, because it was about sexual violence. I think it's very important, on the one hand, for certain people to experience that who never have before. But if you're, like, somebody... a lot like most people, essentially, if you're the majority of people, you will have at some point in your life have experienced some form of sexual violence, right? And so knowing that that's the majority of people, whether it be harassment, somebody shouting you on the street, or something intimate, it's, I don't know about the responsibility of putting everybody through that experience of saying, right, you have to face this challenging thing, to somebody who probably has and likely more than once experienced those things. It feels kind of like there should be a disclaimer saying this show is for somebody who has never experienced not, but then those people wouldn't go and see it. So.
Yes, it's a very fine line. It'd be interesting to see if the people who wrote it actually had that experience, whether it was an autobiographical, something that they could relate to. Were they victims of some sort of sexual violence and wanted to use that as an outlet or as a creative outlet or share that with other people?
Well, the writer of the piece that really kind of freaked me out was a woman. So, like, based on statistics, I don't know how much of the details of the story were based on truth. Again, similar to Good Girl, you don't really know how much is autobiographical, and even if the actual facts aren't autobiographical, the feelings certainly feel very truthful to the writer or performers, you know, their actual reality. So I felt like
on the crux by being like, this is really important, this is really challenging, people should address this, and on the other hand being like, I don't want to address this.
This is really uncomfortable.
Yeah, and uncomfortable in a way that's not like, I'm not learning about somebody else's discomfort in this. I'm not being put through this discomfort so that I can then go out into the world and make a difference and feel like, oh, I've experienced something horrible that has never been directed at me before. If I was being put through something that was really uncomfortable, really unpleasant, but it was because I was being put into the point of view of somebody whose experience I don't know, I might have been more like, yes, this is brilliant, you should go and see it, because, you know, not everyone's experienced this actual situation. Whereas I was being put through a situation which was felt quite familiar to me, and because it was familiar, I was like, I don't need to go through this again, thank you. You know,
certainly, and sounds memorable.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think that's something that Good Girl got right, in that it felt very involving and it felt quite immersive and it felt like we were part of the experience, and the with all the eye contact and everything, I felt like she was looking into my soul at some points in Good Girl, even though she emailed me back after the show and said, did you make it? And I was like, you spent half of the show, what felt like to me, making direct eye contact with my face. But she's obviously, you know, in the character. But I felt like the perfect balance between having that fourth wall, having it's a story, it's imaginary, the fun music, the lightness, the humour, as well as the intensity, the eye contact, the sort of feeling that this could be you on stage.
Definitely. I'd say well done, Naomi, because I think she's done a really good job and created something really interesting and memorable and relatable and realistic, maybe just that little bit extra than realistic, which is what you want from a performance anyway, just the right side of, you know, of dramatized. But yeah, I thought it was amazing.
She's very funny, isn't she?
Yeah, really funny.
Yeah, I'm so glad you enjoyed it.
Yes, I loved it.
Thank you for coming with us.
Thank you for having me.
Finally, the thing we ask all of our guests, hashtag feminist fave, do you have something that you would like to recommend to our listeners? It can be anything that inspires you in a feministy way.
Yes.
Ooh,
come in. Yes, I do. And actually, I thought long and hard about this, and I thought, rather than come up with some of the classic references, I'm going to come up with something very new to me. I read a book when I was on holiday a few weeks ago called A Good Time to Be a Girl, and it's by a lady called Dame Helena Morrissey. And she is often in the press because she's a CEO, a city CEO. She's always voted one of the top 50 influential people in finance, influential people, I would say, not influential women, people. And she is also interesting because she's got 9 children. So I think often, like, people like the Daily Mail will go, city CEO with 9 children, having it all, you know, there's been articles like that. Also in 2010, she started off something called the 30% Club, and it was her aim to get at least 30% board members as women in the big companies in the UK and around the world. Actually, I don't think she's adverse to sort of, you know, creating this as a global thing, and a lot of that has been achieved. She's done really, really well, not just on her own, but, you know, hopefully things are changing a little bit. But so she started off this 30% club, and she's written this book called A Good Time to Be a Girl, and on the dust jacket and in the all the press, she sort of says that it's a follow-up almost to Lean In, Sheryl Sandberg's Lean In, which I really enjoyed. And I'm not an office-bound city corporate person that has this full-time job that I want to go and excel at. You know, I'm a creative and don't do full-time hours, but I could still relate to it. I think a lot of us could relate to Lean In. It was certainly very popular, about, you know, being a little bit intimidated and women not necessarily going forward for promotion, women being overlooked for promotion, women not asking for pay rises, all of those stereotypically female issues that obviously don't apply to everyone but do seem to apply across the board in a big sort of generalization. So she's taking it with A Good Time to Be a Girl, she's taking Lean In a step further, almost saying, and I read every page of the book, read it in a few days, which is remarkable when I had 2 kids around me on holiday, she's saying that rather than Lean In 5 years after Lean In, let's try and change the culture of the company that you work for. She talks a lot about companies because that's what she knows, but you can apply it to other situations if you're not in a company like me. So for her, she gives examples of when she was 25, very young, she had her first child, and she was made redundant while she was on maternity leave because they were like, well, you're not going to be focused on your job.
What?
And then the next position she had, you know, but she's having all these children, nine children is quite unusual, actually, I think
I
we should say.
But
she managed to go into places, work her way up and change the culture. So changing the culture was changing the attitude, changing the board members, having more visible women, but also smaller things like giving everyone the opportunity to choose flexible working, to say work 4 days a week and pack it in, or do half days. And some men chose the options in the companies that she's worked for. Some men choose these options as well. And what she is essentially saying with A Good Time to Be a Girl is that this is a great time to be a girl who's coming forward and can hopefully change the way industries work, especially with new industries, with tech and digital industries and all these different industries, is actually don't lean in, get in there and change the culture. And if you manage to get to a position of power, make sure you change the culture from the top down and let those changes be open to everyone. And the last thing I will say about Dame Helena Morrissey is that I emailed her as soon as I finished the book and I was like, I'd love to have you on my podcast. She replied the next day and I'm interviewing her in a couple of weeks.
Oh, wow.
And I have to say that with wit, it's harder for me to get women guests on the podcast. I have no idea why. It's the men that put themselves forward to things. I think there's a whole plethora of reasons why this might be the case, but she was, yeah, I'm gonna, you know, you're a woman, I'm gonna support you, be on your podcast, I'm gonna, you know, sort of pay it forward, pay it back, whatever, share the love. And I'm interviewing her in a couple of weeks time, so I'm really looking forward to that.
That is such a brilliant story.
She's great, isn't she?
I
sold the
that.
Book to you, it's a really
yes,
good book.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, because Lena never appealed to me, that whole thing about kind of being part of, you know, putting yourself in, like, as a woman into that kind of male businessy capitalist kind of environment just makes me feel a bit ill, really. And yeah, but changing it, making it better for everybody,
exactly,
is so much more appealing. Like that idea that you're not just smashing the glass ceiling and then pulling up the ladder, but you're actually kind of, you know, throwing it down the staircase and saying, yeah, everybody come up, you know, everyone. Not just like one woman, one like rich white lady at the top going, that's it, I've ended sexism.
That's exactly what she's saying. And
that's great.
And she really works tirelessly to, you know, to try and change the culture. And you know, it's not our environment, that corporate working culture, but the messages are, you can sort of change that to whatever what you want to do. And as a mum now, a lot of my friends are mums, and part-time work is a very significant issue because these women, these strong, intelligent women that have had these great jobs, don't just want to drop out the workplace when they have children. But some of them, not all of them, but some people would like to spend more time with their children, mums and dads. And if that can be facilitated without losing their valuable years and skills from any industry, then that is only a good thing. You know, these people are very valuable. You don't want them to drop off and drop out of industries when they've got all this skills and experience. And working now, and she had a good point to make about the millennials and young people. People now don't necessarily want a job for life in a corporate company. They want to change the way work happens, to be able to be sitting on your laptop in a coffee shop or in the bloody Maldives if you want to, wherever you want And again, it's about sort of changing that culture to suit you and finding your own ways of working. And to me, that's my own ways of earning money and not necessarily working for other people. And I found it was really good. And I feel that she's a very interesting, inspirational woman. And I'm actually really looking forward to interviewing her.
That sounds great. Yeah, I really like this idea of making the world more equal for everybody. Paternity leave, I think, is a huge feminist issue. You know, if you've got fathers who go back to work straight away, then you've only got the option of the, you know, if you're a mum who doesn't want to stay at home and spend all of your time with the kids, but you've got a dad who wants to, that should be an option.
And that's what she's done. Her husband is a stay-at-home dad with
great
these nine
and it's
children
better, it's not even just better for that couple themselves, it's better for the kids if they've got a parent at home, or they've got parents who split their time equally and those parents are happier. That it's not only better for the parents who are going through that and wanting to retain their jobs, but it's better for the children being raised. It's raising
exactly
a new generation.
If people are happy in what they're doing and flexible, and so a lot of people that is working, most people love work, you know, work can be really rewarding and exciting, but equally people do want to be with their families and do want to have time. It's not just about kids, to have time to travel, to research, to study. And it's about that sort of idea of flexible working, which to me is just the future, really. Who wants to go and do 12 hours a day for somebody else? I certainly don't.
Not me. No, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank that was you. An awesome feminist fave.
I really enjoyed it, the whole experience. And I wish you every success with the podcast, because it's just a wonderful subject. And we keep fighting the fight.
Yeah, thank you. And you too. I will be listening to the Big Travel Podcast.
We'll subscribe to each other. In fact, I already have. I subscribed to you this morning, so we're done.
We'll subscribe to each other and tell everybody else to subscribe to each other as well.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Lisa.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Again, Lisa, for such a great chat. It was really wonderful, after having seen Good Girl at Edinburgh Fringe by myself, to finally go and see it with somebody and just sit down and talk about it properly afterwards. I had such a great time. And thank you for having me around to record in your lovely home, and for a lovely cup of tea as well. Everybody, you should definitely check out Lisa Francesca Nand on her podcast, The Big Travel Podcast, bigtravelpodcast.com, or on iTunes, or in all the Android apps. Anywhere you can find our podcast, you can find Lisa's podcast. And she's got some incredible interviews there. So you heard a little bit about them. Now it's time to go and listen. Oh, but not quite yet, because I've got some recommendations for you. This episode is nearly done. But first, I've got to say some shows that you should go and see in April. First of all, Coconut. Coconut is one of my most anticipated shows of this year. It's feminist theatre company, The Thelmas. I first saw an extract of this show at the Park Theatre. I knew nothing about these women, but after I'd seen this little short extract of their play, I ran up to them talking at such speed that I think they thought that I must know them from somewhere, but I didn't know them. We'd never been introduced. I just saw their work and immediately wanted to be their friend. So now we're friends, and Coconut has evolved into a full production, and I'm so, so excited to see it. It is Ovalhouse 11th or 28th of April, then it's touring until June 30th, everywhere around the country. If you live in the UK, you're going to get a chance to see Coconut. We're also at Ovalhouse doing a very special Bechdel Theatre post show. It's an audience discussion, so you can come along, join in, tell us what you think about the fact that this is a show with a female driven narrative, with a woman at the centre of it. It's deeply concerned with representation, with feminism, but it doesn't pass the Bechdel test. What? Come and see the show on the 14th of April and have a chat about it afterwards with us. We'd love to see you there. Next up is Scene, which is S-C-E-N-E, like scene of a play, which is on at Camden People's Theatre, the 10th of the 14th of April. You've got a really short window to see it, but this was one that was at Edinburgh Fringe that we didn't get a chance to watch, so I'm definitely going to be catching this at CPT. It's about a... two women in a mixed race queer relationship. It's autobiographical, I think, and it got great reviews at Edinburgh, so I'm really definitely going to be seeing that when it comes back. Then we've got Half-Breed, which I did see both at Edinburgh and at Soho Theatre. I think I talked about it in the episode that was with Bullish. It was episode 6 of the Bechdel Theatre podcast. I've already talked about this show a lot, so I won't bang on about it again. Suffice to say, it's an excellent one-woman show where Natasha Marshall plays a multitude of different characters. She's got accents, physicalities coming out of her ears. You can't believe that it's just one actor on stage, except it is just one actor on stage. Actually, similar in that way to Good Girl. Not thematically, but... in terms of her performance, if you like Good Girl, you should also go and see Half-Breed. If you like Half-Breed, you should also go and see Good Girl. If you like to see a strong woman on stage playing loads of different characters, Half-Breed is at Soho Theatre from 16th to 21st of April. Next recommendation is actually a film. What? But it's because it relates to the previous episode, the last episode of our podcast. If you didn't listen, go and listen to it now, with Giselle Gant from Year of the Rooster Monk, because she was talking about her hashtag feminist fave, Shirley Chisholm, and...
you know, when you hear about something and then it's suddenly it's everywhere. Shirley Chisholm was running for president in 1972, the first woman to ever run for president. And there is a documentary on about her, Chisholm 72, at the Barbican Cinema on the 18th of April. It's a special screening. So if you liked the sound of Shirley from the previous episode, then go and see that at the Barbican Cinema. Next up, we have Nine Night at the National Theatre, 21st of April to the 26th of May. So you've got a while to see that one. It's about a Jamaican family going through their nine nights of mourning, of like a wake for their relative called Gloria, who seems to be quite a kind of important character in the play, centred around this woman who has died. So Nine Night at the National Theatre, directed by Roy Alexander Wise, who directed Stoneface, which was something I really loved a few years ago at the Finborough Theatre. And so I've been keeping an eye on his work ever since. And he's a great, fabulous man feminist, one I highly recommend the work of. Then we've got Mountains, which is Dreams of Lily Kwok. Mountains, Dreams of Lily Kwok is the name of the play, which is on UK tour until the 2nd of June. And that is from Yellow Earth Theatre Company, who put British Asian Centre Stage. The story is about, it's autobiographical, it's based on a memoirs, and the memoir is called Sweet Mandarin, but the play is called Mountains. And it's about a British East Asian woman who journeys to Hong Kong to get to know her grandmother and her family history and all the generations that came before her. So that is on until 2nd of June, on tour everywhere again. And the final one is Our Country's Good, which some of you, if you studied drama at GCSE or A-level, might have read or even seen a production of. It's quite regularly staged. But this one is interesting because it is a co-production between Nottingham Playhouse and Ramps on the Moon Theatre Company, which is a theatre company that focuses on representing deaf and disabled actors and creatives. So it's their take, their new version on Our Country's Good, which is kind of a classic play that you might have heard of before. And that's on tour as well. Leeds, London, Sheffield, Birmingham. It's going everywhere. We are trying to, on this podcast, cover some more shows that are touring nationally, internationally, but we can't often afford to get out of London. So hopefully that has given you, if you are a listener who is elsewhere in the country, some shows that you can look for and actually access. But do let us know if you go and see one of the shows we recommend. Tell us what you thought of it. If you've got a show that you think we should be recommending, do get in touch. You can email us bechdeltheatre@gmail.com, or you can get us on the Twitter and the Instagram and all of that at Bechdel Theatre. So we really hope to hear from you. Let us know what you thought. And enjoy a spring of great theatre. Bye!